What's up, everyone? Alex here, and I love indie game developers. Originally announced for the West in 2017, Sakuna of Rice and Ruin has had a long road to its release. Little was known about the game at the time, other than it aspired to have the same kind of action that VanillaWare delivered, and that it would also feature some farming gameplay. Finally, after 3 years of intense development, Sakuna is finally here. But farming games aren't cut in the same cloth as another, so I went into my review of Sakuna of Rice and Ruin with the hopes and dreams that growing and gathering rice would be approachable as its combat. Sakuna of Rice and Ruin is a 2D action platformer with deep rice farming gameplay, developed by the duo at Edelweiss and published by Xseed, who provided this review code. You play the role of Sakuna, a half-warrior, half-harvest goddess, who was banished from the capital of the Lofty Realm to the Isle of Demons, where she'll not only have to investigate the origin of the horde of demons plaguing the island, but also learn how to live with the children of men who seemingly wandered into heaven uninvited. In order to accomplish this, Sakuna will have to abandon her godly privileges, requiring her to demonstrate her skillful combat prowess while exploring the island, while learning the ways of properly harvesting rice as the seasons progress in-game. The most striking aspect of Sakuna of Rice and Ruin is its action combat, which is evocative of VanillaWare's action games. Apart from using Sakuna's quick and heavy attacks to slice up and juggle enemies, one unique feature of its combat lies with the ability to smash your enemies into each other. This is one of my favorite additions to this kind of combat system, and it allows Sakuna to clear the immediate area around her while still dealing damage to enemies down the line. However, these skills are limited by way of a SP meter that slowly recharges over time. As you explore more of the island, you'll soon learn other skills that utilize the same gauge, forcing you to sparingly use them, as they are costly to use on the regular. With this in mind, and having no dedicated dodge button whatsoever, how is one expected to survive the hordes that litter the screen? That comes in the form of Sakuna's Divine Raiment, a magical scarf that has its own unique set of skills. By default, Sakuna's Raiment will allow you to pull yourself towards various elements on screen, may it be a wall, a ceiling, or a nearby enemy. There is a brief moment of invulnerability each time you zip around the screen using the Raiment, so it's a great way to dodge any incoming strong attacks that you want to avoid. However, it is highly reliant on being around objects. So while it's tempting to clear the screen of enemies and focus on a boss, for example, you might be setting yourself up for a difficult time. Mastering the use of your Raiment, along with the various skills you've unlocked, will be the key to extending your combos and surviving the game's skirmishes, as you'll find that you can easily be overwhelmed if you choose to repeatedly rely on regular attacks and juggles. Unlike VanillaWare's Odin Sphere and Muramasa, whose levels are presented as sprawling Metroidvania-style maps, Sakuna's levels are divided into small, linear areas, each with their own set of objectives. These objectives vary greatly, with some asking you to do rudimentary things such as bouncing things into mushrooms, to defeating a number of enemies of the same type. And the more objectives you clear per area, the more you'll uncover new areas to explore. Each area also yields unique materials that you'll need to craft new weapons and armor, which means that it won't be uncommon for you to revisit an area once or twice. However, the highlight of these areas have to be its boss fights, which are often embedded as part of your exploration. That said, you won't be able to explore these areas forever, as the game features an abbreviated day and night cycle that makes enemies you're facing more powerful in the evening, in addition to rendering the surrounding area in almost pitch black darkness. And if that doesn't stop you from pushing forward, your stomach will. Being hungry means that you won't automatically recover your health when out of combat, which is crucial when wanting to further explore the rest of the island. Unfortunately, you can't take food with you while exploring, meaning you'll have to go back home and have dinner to sate your hunger, which then advances the time to evening. Soon enough, you'll notice that the bosses you're facing serve as a gating factor towards your continued exploration of the island, with your attacks sometimes only dealing 1 point of damage per hit. That's because defeating enemies in Sakuna of Rice and Ruin have absolutely no bearing on how strong you'll become. Instead, your combat stats are tied directly to Sakuna's rice farming mechanics. Unlike games such as Stardew Valley or Rune Factory, Sakuna's rice farming gameplay is significantly more involved and comprises multiple parts. How much more, do you ask? Here are some of the things you'll need to consider. When tilling the soil, you'll have to make sure that it's soft enough for planting. While planting, you'll have to make sure that you're providing ample distance in between to encourage optimal growth. When watering crops, you have to make sure that the water level is just above ankle height. All of these details, and so much more, distinguish this game's farming gameplay from other games with similar mechanics, and the various attributes your crops develop over time will directly determine Sakuna's stat gains once everything's said and done. In other words, in order to make Sakuna more powerful in combat, you'll have to engage with the game's farming through an entire year's worth of in-game time. A year in Sakuna of Rice and Ruin consists of 3 days for each of the four seasons. And while that length of time doesn't seem terribly long, it's long enough for one to get frustrated when dealing with this sort of gameplay for the first time. Because Sakuna herself isn't well versed with farming, the game trickles a few details about the activity over time. While I appreciate the thought put into the decision to mirror your farming experience to that of Sakuna, it doesn't feel good to know that the game seems like it's actively leaving out information for you to stumble upon during your first 2 years with the game. Helpful features, such as gauging how well the ground is tilled or displaying a grid showing the ideal distance between the crops, are all hidden from you, but will eventually unlock over time. While these unlocks are meant to serve as a reward for putting up with the lack of information, these moments instead rob you of the opportunity to feel as though you've been accomplishing something meaningful, forcing you to ask the question whether or not making you experience this hardship alongside Sakuna was all worth doing. After the first 2 years, you'll eventually unlock a way to better check on the status of your rice crops, in addition to scrolls that'll contain some information about what you've been doing and various other pieces of info. However, you'll quickly notice that some aspects of farming that were discussed over the first 2 years are noticeably missing. So despite eventually unlocking a feature that'll allow you to know the water level percentage on your field, for example, you better remember that you need to fill it up to ankle height during the spring, whatever that percentage actually is. Frankly, I was surprised how much more in-depth Sakuna's rice farming mechanics were compared to other games in the genre. And having played around with it for hours, I can certainly appreciate the developer's passion to reflect as many of rice farming's real-life considerations in its gameplay. To engage with Sakuna's rice farming means asking you to be very patient, and accepting that, for the first few years, you're most likely going to stumble a bit. And if you're the kind of gamer who possesses these qualities, you'll find a lot to examine, dive, and dissect here. However, for the rest of us who are expecting this gameplay to be just as easy to pick up and play as the game's combat, these design decisions might feel like a misstep. While the farming aspect of Sakuna can be a bit overwhelming, the rest of the game's systems will make sense quickly within the first few hours of gameplay. And it's through these systems that its developers demonstrate a deep understanding of how to create interesting decisions for the player to partake in. For example, the hunger mechanic mentioned earlier is tied directly to selecting which dishes to make for dinner, which will then determine what kinds of buffs and stat boosts you'll have when you go out exploring the following day. And in case you missed it the first time, Sakuna's hunger only matters if you need to automatically recharge your health out of combat, meaning you can keep exploring as much of the island as you want, provided that you're really good at dodging attacks from enemies. In other words, it's a system that doesn't feel too punishing, and one that feels rewarding for players who love taking risks. Speaking of food, one unique way that Sakuna delivers its narrative is through the dinner conversations you share with the children of men, which happens to be one of my favorite parts of the game. It's during these moments that we get to learn a lot about the humans Sakuna's been banished with, often providing surprisingly deep backstories that'll catch you by surprise. I love these conversations because you get a good sense of each character's growth and how they're all acclimating to the challenges ahead. There's also something intimately peaceful and calm about ending your day in this manner, serving as the perfect bookends to the busyness that you partook in. Sakuna of Rice and Ruin is a remarkable adventure from a pair of passionate and ambitious developers. It's quite overwhelming to think about how much they've accomplished with this game, and it's even just as unfathomable that they were able to infuse a huge amount of depth to so many aspects of its design. And while its rice farming gameplay might disappoint players expecting a more approachable experience, anyone who decides to stick around for its combat and storytelling will find a fairly engaging and heartwarming time at the Isle of Demons.